we are here till 7, so we don't want to keep you all past that time. Welcome to the Homestead Road St. Rosa School Improvement Project meeting. Thank you all for being here on tonight. I always say you could have gone anywhere tonight, but you chose to come here and be with us, and we do appreciate that, and we thank you for it. A little bit of housekeeping before we get started. I just want to let you all know that there, if you need to use the restrooms, they're outside of this door, and they're just down the hall. Women's on the right and men's on the left. People will go down here and make a right, and then to the right is the women's, and then to the left is the men's restroom. If those, for some reason, are full, if you keep going down the hall onto the other side of the main entrance, there are restrooms on that side as well. There are two exits from this building so that if there is an emergency, you can exit out of the doors here or you can exit out of the doors there. Okay? Next slide. And I'm going to introduce the members of the project team. And we have Hassan Basma, who is, he is our project manager. And we have Laura Ledbetter, she is a senior transportation planner. Myself, Nanam Carter, and I work in community outreach. Zila Shafi, who is our project manager at Dean's Corps. And Nabila Hazara, who is a Dean's Corps project engineer. Next slide. And tonight, just go over our agenda for tonight really quick. We're going to give you a little bit of information on the project and the background and an overview of that. We're going to go over the project goals. We'll talk about the design, and then we'll talk about the project cost, the schedule, and then our upcoming outreach meetings that we do ask you all to come to and to participate in. And then we'll go over our question and answer. We'll have a question and answer period for you. And then before we start our presentation, I am going to recognize, I think I got all of our elected officials here tonight or their representatives, I am not sure. But I will say who I have, and if you would like to have words, please feel free to do that before we start. I have a Lynette Lee Eng from Los Altos City Council. Yeah. Would you like to have words?
No, not necessarily.
Thank you. And then I have, I believe it's Rika Kim.
Rosa
Kim, sorry. That's
good. I wrote this and I can't see this.
Rosa Kim, would you like to have words?
No, okay.
Stanley Kuhn.
Thank you for hosting this event. That student bike and walk is very important. Safety is most important part. Thank you.
Thank you.
Their affiliation?
Oh, I'm sorry. And he's from the Fremont Union High School District. And Graham Clark, he's also from the Fremont Union High School District. Is this a
Yeah.
Would you like to have her?
Sure, yeah. On behalf of the district, you know, Homestead is on Homestead Avenue, so it's a very important corridor, and we support all the efforts here to make it safer for students. Thank you.
And there's Chris Zanardi, who is representing Supervisor Sumidian. Would you like to have words?
No, thanks.
Okay, and then we have Linda Sale, who's a Sunnyvale City Council person.
Hi, I just wanted to thank everyone for coming here. I'm in Sunnyvale. My district runs, Homestead runs in my district. So very important to us and our community. So thank you for coming here.
Thank you. And we have Ava Shao, who's from the Cupertino Union School District.
Hi, welcome. I love that to hear that this is being put on because it really hasn't had traction since the pandemic has happened. And in our district, we have West Valley Elementary School and Cupertino Middle, which is on the Homestead Corridor. So thank you all for being here.
Thank you. And we have our BTA, BPAC chairperson, Stacy Benninger.
Thank you. Hello, everyone.
project to me because my son goes to Homestead High School, and I have seen many students hurt on this road going to and from school, including one last month where I had to call 911. So time is of the essence. Let's get this done.
Thank you. Thank you. Thank you. I appreciate that. Did I miss anybody? I'm not going to leave anybody out. Okay, thank you, thank you. Okay, and now we will go forward. These are our public meeting goals on tonight. And so what we will do is we will go over our past project activities and give you all a summary of the things that we have done thus far. And then we want to address some of the concerns that we've heard thus far as well. And then we want to talk about the design concepts, which I know some of you have already taken a look at that are in our exhibits in the back of the room. And then we want to discuss what our next steps are and our public outreach. Okay. And I'm going to bring up Hassan.
Thank you, Nina. Good evening. My name again is Hassan Basma. Engineering Transportation Manager with VT, and I'm the Project Manager for this project. So before I start, I just want to acknowledge again the cities, Sunnyvale, Cupertino, Los Altos, and the county for being here. Appreciate that, and for being good partners in this project. So a quick background, but before I get that, I just want to background is just to let you know how we got here. So in November 2016, the voters of Santa Clara County approved a Measure B, which was a 30-year half-cent sales tax. It was to support transportation projects and services. And in that measure, local streets, roads, bicycles, and pedestrians programs were included in that measure. In 2018, the County Board of Supervisors, Jesse Median, championed this project, and we really want to say thank you to him. And also thank you to, again, the cities and the county and all those who actually wrote letters to support this project. In 2019, the County of Santa Clara Roads and Airport completed the study project. And they met with community twice, and they got some input from the communities and also from the local jurisdiction. And they came up with a preferred alternative. In 2023, the 2016 Measure B funds were secured, and the project went to bid for design and was awarded to DIMS Corp. Next slide, please. Actually, I would like to call Lauren to talk briefly about the presentation about past project activities and understanding the project concerns.
Thanks, Hassan. So I'm Lauren Ledbetter. I'm a senior transportation planner at VTA. I manage the bicycle and pedestrian program. And I was the VTA representative on the county's effort to do feasibility study for the safe routes to school homestead project. So as Hassan mentioned, in that feasibility study that the county led, there were two public meetings held in November 2018 and February 2019. About 60 people attended both of those meetings. They're at both Homestead High. And we basically, the county used that as a way to understand the problems that the community was facing and come up with some conceptual designs. The collaboration, as Hassan mentioned, was very close with all the different agencies. This core is really special, because it goes through county, unincorporated county, it goes through Cupertino, it goes through Sunnyvale, it goes through Los Altos. The reason why VTA is leading it is because when the 2016 Measure B competitive grant programs came up, VTA asked cities and the county, are there any projects that you would like us to apply for and lead? We'll do this for multi-jurisdictional projects that are regionally significant. Homestead is on the cross-county bicycle corridors for the county, and it's multi-jurisdictional. So The county asked us to lead the project. We got support from the partner agencies, and we submitted a grant application that Hassan mentioned to do the next phase, which is the design, which is where we are now. So you go to the next slide. So I just wanted to summarize what we heard. Just this is basically from the feasibility study. And also note that the project team that you see here tonight with you, we have walked the corridor, we've observed the students coming to and from school, the biking in the reverse direction of traffic, the bike lanes, the conflicts at the driveways, the overcrowded sidewalks and that sort of thing. So there's multiple locations where there's issues with students not being able to cross the street safely. Like I mentioned, some of the corners are really small, with a lot of students walking. You can't fit everyone on the corner, they step out into the street. There's vehicle and bicycle conflicts that we are aware of and seen videos of even. There's a need to improve visibility at crosswalks. There's particularly some locations like at Fallen Leaf Lane. Although the city has made improvements to that intersection, there's a desire to see better improvements so vehicles yield better at that location. And I mentioned this briefly, but one of the biggest issues that we see is 11, 12, and 13-year-olds biking the reverse direction of traffic on the road, in the bike lane, through the SR85 interchange to get to Cupertino Middle. So we've put together a plan that we're hoping will help address that problem. The multi-use paths and sidewalks aren't wide enough. And there's also gaps in the corridor, and our project goes a bit beyond the feasibility study and actually crosses Foothill Expressway, and there's sidewalk improvements proposed on Christ, but also Diodor Drive, right? I'll let Hassan talk about it. So you can go to the next slide. I think this goes back to Hassan, right? Okay. So essentially what you see here is taking what was the preferred alternative in that feasibility study from 2019 and going in and getting all the detail and the information that you need to bring it to something that is actually buildable. And in that process, of course, we're going to uncover things that make it challenging to do exactly what was said in the feasibility study. So you'll see there's some back and forth there. And I think I will turn it over to Hassan to talk about this.
Thank you, Lauren. So what you see up here is the project area map. I'm pretty sure everybody is familiar with the project corridor. As you can see, it's the project limits starts at Grant Road and goes going eastward. We go over Stevens Street, and then we go over the State Route 85. And the corridor runs close by these three schools that are there, West Valley Elementary School, Cupertino Middle School, and Homestead High School. And the project limits ends at Holland Beck. Next slide, please. So what are the project goals? As you can see here, we want to implement bicycle and pedestrian infrastructure improvement for safe routes to schools. And also, at the same time, want to support safe and efficient modes of transportation for biking, walking, driving, and riding public transit. We also want to connect those three schools that I mentioned, which are the West Valley Elementary School, Cupertino Middle School, and Homestead High. Next slide. So design considerations, Lauren mentioned some of these. So we want to install new sidewalks to close some of the gaps that exist right now. And we want to widen sidewalks and shared use paths where feasible. And we also want to convert bike lanes to buffered or protected bike lane wherever feasible. We also want to tighten some of the corner curb radar and shorten crossing distance to make it a complete street. And then install new ADA ramp for improved accessibility and also improving traffic signals. And then there are some areas where we want to upgrade to high visibility crosswalks to improve pedestrian crossings. And a couple of places we want to eliminate free ride tolling, which is on Foothill Expressway and South 85, South State Route 85 on ramp. So what you see here is a rendering. There's a plant over there, and actually the renderings are also shown there. But we thought this would be good for you to understand, to see what it would look like once we're done with the project. So on this one, on this rendering, this cross section here, it's between Homestead and Christ Drive. Is it Christ or Christ? I always
Christ.
Christ.
Christ. Christ.
There's no
okay. Thank you. Between Christ Drive and Homestead Road. So we're looking, we're going that way, we're looking southeast. So as you can see, we're widening the sidewalk on the left side, and we're installing bike lane with buffer on the left side. On the right side, we're installing a protected bike lane. And again, this is just to explain some of the stuff we're doing, but it's when you're done, you can take a look, it's back there. Next slide, please. So going eastward, we have Fallen Leaf Lane to Bellevue Way. And if you look at the left side, we have a widening share use path. And this is for folks to, pedestrians to walk and your bicyclists to ride. And then we install bike lanes, protected bike lanes on both sides of the street. So on State Route 85 Bridge, looking east again, from Maxine to Bernardo, you see we're installing a protected two-way cycle track, and Lauren kind of alluded to that. This is to make sure, as we all know, the students ride the opposite way, and this is to make it a safe way to do that. And we do have sidewalk improvements, and we'll be installing protected bike lanes also on the right side. And this is Bernardo Avenue looking south. So you can see next to the Cupertino Middle School entrance, we do have an RRFB, which is actually a pedestrian flashing signal. And we are widening the sidewalk on both sides, and we're installing a bike lane with buffer on the right side. So funding, as I mentioned earlier, we have secured BTA from BTA Measure B $1.167 million, and Senatara County Roads and Airports contributed $350,400. So we do have a total of about 1.5 million. And what this does is it makes us go do 35% design and also environmentally clear the project. We do not have funding to complete the project yet, to go final and for construction. So what we see here, the 1.5 million is only for doing 35% and environmentally clearing the project. Next. So construction cost estimates. Based on the 35% design that we do have a construction estimate of $12 million. And with that, we take about 20% of that for construction management. We do have to hire people to oversee the construction and work on that. And that's 20% is $2.4 million. And then we add a contingency amount of 20%, which is $2.4 million, for a total construction cost estimate of $16.8 million. I must say here, we have not added anything for right-of-way. We are 35% design, so we don't know what kind of impact we're going to have on right-of-way, we need the right-of-way or not. Hopefully we don't. And if we do, this cost might change. And again, as we get better design, get into the details, this cost will change. It might either go up or come down, but we'll update you as we get those costs. Next. Schedule. As you all know, the project study report was done in 2019, The 35%, the 35% plan, the draft was submitted to VTA in February. We have reviewed it and we've given back comments to the designers. They're working on it to finalize that. And once they finalize that, we'll get it back in June of this year. Right now, we are arranging public meetings like this and also going to the DPAC and city councils. And that is being scheduled between now and June of this year. Environmental clearance is expected to start next month, and it should last, it should go all the way to February 2025. Then we'll have to take it to the board and get it approved. The next three that you see, there's an asterisk there because it depends on future funds. If we do get funding ASAP, we will have final plans by October of 2025, and we'll do the bidding between January of 2025, I think that's 2020, and 2026, June of 2026. Construction is expected from 2026 to 2027, so we're looking at about a year and a half for construction. Next slide, please. Outreach. Is this my slide or is this my slide? Yeah. Well, like I mentioned, upcoming outreach meetings, we are going to be going to, you know, BPAC, Somerville BPAC, and the Los Altos Complete Streets Commission, and we'll be going also to VTA BPAC, and Somerville City Council and Los Altos City Council. So these are the meetings I was talking about. We will be doing these between now and June of this year. This is Jeffrey's video.
Thank you. Okay, so we are going to go into our question and answer period. If you would like to, we have a QR code for our website there, so if you would like to access our website, feel free to take a snap of the QR code there. Also, we do have some comment cards on the table, so if you have questions or comments that you would like to make and you want to put them in writing, feel free to do that, and then you can just give them to myself or another staff member that is here. You can also email your questions and comments to our email address, which is community.outreach@vta.org, and again, you can visit our website. This meeting is being recorded, and we are going to put it on our YouTube channel, and then we will also post it to our page. And we do ask that you give us about 48 hours or up to 48 hours to get that posted.
Okay.
And just a little bit more housekeeping on our Q&A session. We do just ask that everyone please be cordial to your neighbors. We may have differences of opinions on tonight, so we just ask that you all be respectful of each other. And I'm gonna stop there. I used to say some other things, but I don't think I need to say them tonight. So yeah, as long as we're respectful to each other, then we'll be okay. Okay. And anyone who wants to start, you can feel free to start. I don't know if we're big enough or if you guys want to speak loud enough, that's fine. If not, and you need some, you know, we need to hear, I'll run around with the mic.
Yes, from the very beginning, like 9 years ago when we started to lobby with Councilman Supervisor Smidian, and I'm almost about to go open. Can everybody in the back here?
Give the mic. And that way it'll get recorded too.
Okay.
Right?
Okay. Thank you.
If that's okay.
Many years ago when we started this process with Supervisor Smidian, lobbying, cooking to help us in this effort, part of our main concerns were young children as well as tweens and teens crossing the public expressway as well as Grant Road and St. Joseph's Road, yet we see that this scope range has been cut short. And eliminated the most dangerous portions of the travel that our children do to get to school. How do we get that put back in? Getting to Arboretum, where we've got heavy commercial area with, you know, an auto shop and dry cleaners and delis and Lucky's and, you know, buses that are running through, the BTA runs along that route. It's definitely within, you know, the jurisdiction of the BTA.
Thank you.
I'm going to try to answer that. I was not involved in the planning study, so I don't know how they got to that, the limits of the project. I believe the Santa Clara County was the one who did this, but there was community input, and so I am not sure if I think with the community inputs, it was determined, and again, that's why I said it was the preferred alternative. There were different alternatives that was done, but it was decided that this was the alternative that they want to go with. I don't know, Lauren, is there something you want to add to that on how the project limit was determined?
I can answer that question. Actually, could you go to the the specific street that you were?
Arboretum. Yeah, Arboretum and St. Joseph.
Is it on the map?
No,
it's the next one. Oh, it's the next one. Okay, got it. All right. I do know that as part of the Measure B grant that we submitted, we do work with the city staff to figure out the limits, and I believe actually extending it up to include some of up to Christ was actually extending the limits from the original feasibility study. So I don't recall having a conversation about the extending it further. So I do want to mention though that the county is actually going to be starting a feasibility study for improving conditions along Foothill Expressway soon. They're going to be presenting about it to the BTB PAC meeting this month. So like in next week. So that might be an opportunity to have the county take a look at, because anything on related to Foothill Expressway, it is within the county jurisdiction. So
if I may add also, any questions, they're being recorded, right?
Yes.
So we'll get with the right people and see how that was determined and then get back to you.
Great, thanks.
Did you fill out a comment card?
Sorry?
Go ahead.
No. Yeah, did you fill out a comment card?
I
want to grab a comment card for you just so we can make sure we have your information.
Absolutely.
Okay.
Yeah, perfect. I did sign in and I registered online, but we can do that as well.
Yes,
yeah.
Yes, thank you.
Thank you for doing this. It's very informative. Two or three points that I want to make regarding the plan that I've seen here. One is when you're trying to solve, where's Lauren? The problem of to enable Cupertino Middle School students to ride against traffic in the bike lane, which is a great observation because it's very busy there. There are still two car lanes that I've seen in this design here in the presentation on the SR 85 bridge. I'm talking about westbound. And there's only one lane going eastbound. Also, these two lanes merge into one lane. And in the design over there on the wall, there is one traffic lane for cars, which makes a lot more sense if you want to enable a cycle path there. So I would totally look at reducing into one lane earlier, if that's possible. I think should not be too much there, and would enable the Cupertino Middle School students' safe way to school there. When they continue and go into their school and use Bernardo northbound bike lane that you've shown here in the presentation, this lane where it is used for cars to drop off and pick up. So if you put the bike lane there, it's just not going to be usable at all during drop off and pick up time. So this is, it's not solving anything for the students, which your path or improved path behind the gas station does. And the last thing is the whole mess of here on the left, Grant and Foothill intersecting with Homestead together. There's just way too many intersections there to make it safe. And as part of the project, I would ask you to remove a lot of these intersections. If you walk around there and just count the number of in and outs for cars that you cross just going eastbound from your neighborhood on Vineyard, whatever it might be, towards Homestead High School or CMS, on the right-hand side, so eastbound, you cross the gas station and about five more in and out of cars. It's impossible to put a safe bike lane there. There are cars also turning into there, need less intersections. Just close some of them so it's more manageable. Thank you very much.
Thank you for those. We will definitely work with the local jurisdiction and see what we can come up with. As BTA, we cannot just make decisions on our own, so we need to work with the county and the cities. But thank you, though.
I'm trying to get to everybody.
Just a couple of comments on both the previous feedback. One is definitely if the scope of this project does not change, I think it is important to consider BTA or the county or whoever is working on the extension, because it's not necessarily Foothill, but the frontage road which actually falls inside the city's jurisdiction. So this confusion of a multi-jurisdiction extends further beyond. So any implementation here, I would strongly urge you to also reach out to the other agencies considering so that the bike lane continues in a more sensible way. So that it's not a two-way bike lane here that switches into a no bike lane, a shared road, etc. Another point related to the same problematic intersection of Homestead, Grant Road, Vineyard, Foothill Expressway is to consider extending two-way protected bike lanes the entire way. The current situation of having a bike lane that goes through traffic triangles that has to cut across multiple intersections is extremely unsafe. There is no protection, and even just continuing that and adding more striping or wider striping just doesn't make anything to improve the safety. To really look at all the businesses that were mentioned and to really eliminate some of the triangles, some of the intersections, and to make use of that extra space to put two-way protected bike lanes that carries children all the way through the frontage road and drops them off at the end of a two-way bike corridor near Bernardo would really be the ideal solution. I urge you to consider that.
Thank you. Did you want to respond to that?
Okay. I was wondering what your plan is with the displacement of students biking or walking to school due to the construction you're going to have on the bike lanes for the 1.5 years.
Very good question. So usually what we do, like I said, we're at the 35% design right now, but when we get the final package, we do have detours and traffic control plans that will show all that, how we will manage. We haven't started looking at that yet because it's all in the design phase, but we will get into that. We'll get plans in the final design.
And the reason why my daughter is asking that question is my other daughter is in school. They did the same in Joseph, someone mentioned Joseph, growing up. It was 9 months of construction. They just finished, and they're starting to dig again the whole time, right? And the kids are bearing to the left, and all the cars are hitting kids left and right.
Well, I appreciate it. That's a very, really good question. I appreciate that.
Can I make an ask that everybody to speak in the microphone so it's recorded? Thank you.
Thank you.
to the front here, and then I'll make my way back.
Hey, good evening. My name is Graham Clark. I'm the superintendent with the Fremont Union High School District, and I'm actually the former principal of Homestead High School. But I just want to thank the PTA for hosting this night, and we work closely with the cities of Los Altos, Cupertino, and Sunnyvale, and serving the students of those areas. And I think our ask would be the Kennewick intersection, which is shown here. It's actually near our student parking lot. That's probably the area of biggest concern for us, is how do the students on bikes access and also walkers access that area. And we worked with the city of Sunnyvale on the Mary Avenue. We have the Scramble intersection, and that was a great, I think, addition, and it just made it much safer on Mary Avenue. And I think Kennewick Avenue is our main concern there, is how students access the parking lot and biking, bike racks and things like that from that intersection. Thank you.
Thank you so much for doing this work. It's so wonderful to see bike accommodations and pedestrian accommodations, which I thoroughly champion. And I want to bring up the Kennewick intersection to the bike racks that Graham Clark just mentioned, and that is my main concern as well. It's a dangerous route for students from all the way from the intersection along the sidewalk or the student parking lot to the bike racks. And I wanted to say that this entrance into the school is one of two entrances into the school, and it's the second busiest, so it is well used. And there are multiple hazards. We have video of a student being struck by a car who was going counter flow to the car traffic, and he was struck while riding on the sidewalk crossing the student parking lot exit by a car. So it's really what originally prompted us to champion making this route safe. And I want to encourage you to work closely with the FUHSD, and thanks, Lauren, for mentioning that and making that your intention. I want to mention that the Kennewick intersection itself and the multi-use path along Homestead was, I believe it was part of the VERBS grant project that was what built the Mary Avenue Scramble phase. And so it was intended to be done, but it wasn't because the project ran out of money. So I'm hoping that BTA can pick that up now in the current project and make it safer for students. Thanks.
Thank you. Yeah, we've heard about the Kennewick intersection a lot, and we do have concern about that. We've been talking to the cities to see how we can come up with. To say here, the grant that we got, the Measure B grant that we funding that we got, there's a specific scope of work that was that's tied to the money, and if we do any change of scope, we'll have to go back and explain to them what we need to do, and also the board. When we went for board approval for this project, there's this specific scope also that we said we were going to do. So what I'm saying is, all your suggestions and stuff, we do look at them and see what kind of impact it has, if it has a cost or a schedule impact, If it does, there's a process that we need to go through so that we can implement those changes.
I'm gonna go here and then I'll go this way.
I'm Kevin Jackson, a longtime Safe Routes to School volunteer, and I live just a few blocks from Homestead High. I've been riding on Homestead for almost 50 years. Seen a lot of close calls, so I'm really glad to have been in a few myself. Really glad to see these improvements moving forward, and I just want to second what the superintendent and Charlene have said about Kennewick. I think all these improvements are great, but with everything lined up, it would really seem like a shame not to include Kennewick. This came out of some observed collisions there, a lot of dangerous situations that the students face every day, and we've taken quite a long look at it and come up with some ideas that are really pretty simple. I don't think they'd be too expensive, and considering the kind of things we see there happening every day, I think it would be well worth the investment. So please consider including these if you possibly can. Thank you.
My name is Jonathan Weinberg. I'm the mayor of Los Altos. I want to thank this team very much for getting this project as far as it has gotten. An awful lot of work went into that, and I want to acknowledge it. I don't think anyone in here thinks that it's perfect yet. I don't think the team thinks that it's perfect yet. I think that there's going to be a lot more community input, and I'm looking forward to it. What has frustrated me most about this project is that the funding never seems to get there. It's slated to get funded, and then another project slides up in front of it. I also represent Los Altos on the VTA BPAC, and I've seen the list of projects. There's the green there, the high priority, and the yellow, where this project is, which is kind of in the middle, and then there's the red, which is still kind of in development. And I've seen other projects jump in front of Homestead, and that's not to say that those other projects are not worthy or not important. Of course they are. But I'd really like any insight that you can give as to what we as cities, school districts, community organizations, parent organizations, cycling organizations can do to kind of put pressure on whoever it is that's making funding decisions, and what we can do to support you to make sure that this goes forward. Related to that, I'm happy to hear that the Foothill Expressway project was on your radar, and it's something that really needs to happen. I'm concerned that some of the VTA is going to say, well, Los Altos and Cupertino, they got some love with Homestead, so we're gonna push Foothill out until 2030, 2040, 2050. Is there any kind of reassurance you can give that that won't happen, or is there anything we can do to put pressure again on people who do make these decisions to ensure that that doesn't happen? And finally, I would like to invite you, and I would love if you could commit to come and present to the Los Altos City Council on April 30th. That's Tuesday evening, and I can make sure that you get on the agenda.
We're definitely going to the Los Altos City Council, and do you remember the date?
No,
you don't remember the date offhand, but we think it might be the date you had mentioned. Okay. I am not a funding expert, but I would say one of the challenges across the board for bicycle pedestrian projects is that there just isn't enough money to go around. The money that is there, we're all fighting for scraps, and if it's a competitive grant program, there's usually a lot of different criteria, and you need to basically hit every single criteria, and unfortunately in this area, it's not 100% on every single That said, I think having champions, I mean, this got kicked off because of a champion in Supervisor Sneed. I wouldn't have started without the initial seed money that he provided to do the feasibility study. And that got the ball rolling when BTA was able to do the Measure B grant. And we were actually quite lucky. We scored fairly low, and we actually, for this study, we actually jumped ahead of some other projects because of just the way the funding worked out. But that was just one example of it benefiting this project. I would say talking about the project to everyone that you see, writing letters of support, and when we do go out for grants, we will be asking for letters of support for the project. And if you're a student or a parent and you document something, share it with us, because it's really, really compelling for grant programs if we can have the actual lived experience of the students and the parents and the families when these sorts of things happen. So we need to tell an excellent story so that the people who are reviewing grants will understand how important this project is. And advocate just across the board for more bicycle pedestrian funding. So.
Okay, we have time for one more question, so I'm gonna come over. Oh, I see two hands. Okay. If we can make it really quick and we can get both questions in, that would be great. I don't want to, it's almost 7 o'clock and I want you guys to be able to look at the boards. So,
there you go. Ava Chow, Cooper Junior Union School District. So, piggyback on Mayor Weinstein's question, we had a 2x2 in February 24th, a couple months ago, with Councilwoman Ng, the City of Los Angeles, and my colleagues from Fremont Union High School District. Funding. It seems like the only thing that will hold us back from this plan going forward is funding. And I ask of those who are here, wants to get the funding done. It sounds like there are 18, I'm looking it up, VTA board members, representatives from different cities in our county, Santa Clara, that, you know, show up to the board meetings, go to public comments, talk about that. Talk to them individually, from Supervisor Adelie to Sergio Lopez and Campbell. They have different, and to show them that the community thinks this is important so that they can fund it. It seems like the only thing that's holding us back. It's not the community, because you all are here, but it's the funding part and having them make this as a priority. As we all know, walking, biking, to school in different forms, skateboarding, whatnots. This is an equity issue as well. You know, kids who have parents who are working, they need to get themselves to school. Also, we're trying to teach our kids to be independent, climate friendly. So I ask of you all, I think in addition what you're saying is the funding is to tell people about documenting your stories, but who are the ones that decision making at the end of the day? Anything that's over $500,000 has to be up to the VTA board. So that's my ask. And I'm going to be doing my part meeting all the officials that I know that are on that board to talk about funding this project. Thank you.
Hi, I'm Linda Stell, and I'm City Council member in Sunnyvale. And I'm speaking in my own personal capacity. Earlier this year, we had a study issue ranking. That's where we rank all these study issues. And one of the study issues was to make improvements on Homestead and the other high school we have in our city. And the importance of high school safety, it ranked number one out of many, many study issues. So our city, our city council, really is concerned about safety. Some of the improvements that in my study issue that I recommended for Homestead, our staff suggested that it might be redundant with what was going on here. So I just hope that you keep working with the city staff, and if there's areas that might be added improvements, like if Kennywood, which I heard here several times, could be done in some way, then that would be much appreciated. But I hope that you will work with all the city staff. And thank you for your work. Thank you for everyone being here. Excellent work. Thank you.
say that this is a, you know, great activity. I'm looking forward to the visual cues, because even when the problem is, even when the kids are careful, they have their bike lights on and everything, sometimes cars, you know, mobile phone or something, they're the distracted driver, and it's easier for them to go into the bike lane. And if anything that we can do that, you know, protects that, that gives visual cues to drivers that they are kind of going into the bike lane, that's like a big plus for safety, especially on Homestead Road, because that is like very busy. 85 people going and 85 people around, taking exit and coming there. So that stretch is like really critical and dangerous. So thank you. Thanks for doing that.
Thank you. Appreciate it. Son, did you have anything to say before? Okay. So we're going to go ahead. It's 7 o'clock. And I do want you all to be able to look at the exhibits and to ask questions. We have the room. We have to be out by 7:30. So what I'm going to do is at 7:10, I'm going to get the mic and I'm going to let you all know you have 10 more minutes. At 7:20, it'll be time to exit. So from now, so that's about 19 minutes. So that I think we can give you all and still be out by 7:30. And then you can all ask Hassan and Lauren questions as well.
Yeah, that's what I was going to say. Some people might not want to do public grad questions. We are available. You can ask us questions and then help the boards or plans that you see there.
The people here who can answer questions about the boards, can they raise?